Okay, I'd like to call a meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. Monday, November 14th at 7 p.m. This meeting is being televised by the Frontier Community Access Television. And the first thing on our agenda is minutes. I'd like to make a motion that we approve the minutes of October 31st, 2016. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
They look good.
Good. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And motion carries. Next item is warrants. We have a vendor warrant for $64,796, a payroll warrant for $109,058. We have a payroll deduction warrant for $29,268. Do we have a motion to accept that?
So moved.
Any discussions? No discussions?
We're pretty
dry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. Next thing, meetings attended by the selectmen.
So I had a bunch, yeah, as usual. It seems every week or two we have a lot of meetings. So the Energy Committee has been doing a lot of work on the solar project. And so Bryce sent those of us who've been attending his meetings a link to join a conference call about 2 weeks ago to talk about the new SREC program, the Solar Renewable Energy Credit Program, that will be adopted probably after January 1st, you know, but probably will be the program that Conway would be under, and it's a lot less generous than the program that exists now.
Is it less generous than the one they talked about?
No. And what I was interested to see whether this consulting organization that ran this conference call agreed with the consultants that Conway has hired, that the Energy Committee, and they did agree. So mm-hmm. So that was good to know. And so anyway, it was interesting to hear it all explained mm-hmm. from a different, you know, group. Mm-hmm. And anyway, that was interesting. And we had our monthly FCAT meeting. Conway is still a member of an organization called MCAP, which is the Municipal Coalition Against Pipelines, mm-hmm. and they're still in the process of figuring out what their role is going to be, but there's a lot of energy-related activity going on, and so we have a meeting about every couple months for MCAP. And I share those meetings with Jim Moore,
he's one of our reps.
Yeah. And then FERCOG runs a lot of really excellent training programs for select board members, and they had one on the public records law this week. And Conway also is still a member of an organization called Wired West, and Wired West's main activities are helping towns build fiber optic networks in the town in towns that have no broadband at all, but they're also working with Comcast for the extension that Conway is doing, and 10 other towns, and so we had a meeting on Saturday.
Is that still being worked on?
And that's still, you know, we're now 3 months into that program. So there's three phases to that program. There's a 6 month phase where they study the poles and then design the network in each town, and then a 6 month program where they complete the construction of half of the towns, mm-hmm. of half of the homes spread across the towns, and we don't have a schedule for that yet, right. But they say there'll be about half of the homes in every town, and then a 6 month program for the other half of the homes in all of the towns. And so we're now 3 months into that first six months survey and design.
Been in town, 'cause I saw it.
And you'll see their trucks all around. That's right.
Good. Good.
That's it for me.
That's it. All right. Next thing on the agenda is citizens' concerns. Does anybody have any concerns, Tom? Do you know?
There are no.
No? Okay.
She's a that. Citizen, and I don't think she's here for a concern.
Next thing, all business. We are here to meet Giselle Italian on the Cultural Council. Welcome to the Council.
Thank you.
I don't know how many members on that now, do you?
There are five of us, I believe. We're meeting on Friday to review the applications mm-hmm. for the grants.
And you're still down one member, I guess, we understand?
Someone did resign, uh-huh. who was coming on new, so she hadn't been on the council yet, but she had said yes, and now she resigned, mm-hmm. so But we do have a forum, so we can go ahead on Friday.
Do you have any good projects coming up that you know of?
You know what? I haven't looked at the grants yet.
Okay.
I'm going to do that.
Yeah. That's right. They got to select them pretty quick, right?
Yeah. So.
Did they have a good response?
We did. I just read, I think we have over 20 applications.
Wow. That's good.
And I think we have over $6,000 to give out and maybe $12,000 worth requests. So we've got to eliminate a lot of probably great applications. So.
No, that's really good that you had that many responses.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's good.
I'm excited.
Great. I'm good.
Sounds great.
I'm good. Well,
thank you for coming in and showing your face to the people.
People with the camera?
Yep. That's right.
Of the Frontier region.
Great. Well, we appreciate you coming in. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Perfect example of that we need more volunteers.
That's for sure, right?
You've always got to put a plug in for that.
Next thing is to sign a letter of descent of the Marshall Field family, inviting him to the 250th anniversary next June.
Yep. Yes, and there is a letter in the yellow folder for that.
That's Should on, I read this or not?
It's on good paper. Well, you can if you like.
Okay.
This was drafted by the 250th committee.
Dear Mr. Field, we are writing you on behalf of the town of Conway, which is proud to be celebrating its 250th anniversary next June 16th through the 18th, 2017. Given the importance of the Field Memorial Library to our town and its residents for over 100 years, we are hoping that you and your family will consent to an invitation to attend the festivities. The celebration commences with a block party in the center of town by the library and fireworks display on Friday evening, followed by multiple events and exhibits staged over the weekend, including a parade on Sunday. We leave the extent of the participation up to you. If you would like to be in the parade, we will ensure a place of honor in it for you. If parades are of interest, perhaps a couple of seats on the library lawn to watch the events are more suitable. This will allow county residents to meet you and provide them with the opportunity to express their appreciation for the previous gift of the library. And of course, you should feel free to enjoy some of the activities and exhibits, agricultural, arts, landscape designs, plays, and more being held over the weekend. For your comfort, we offer you the choice of staying in one of the Conway's fine bed and breakfasts locations or at the Deerfield Inn. And as an added inducement, should you have the time and inclination, we will set you up with a fly fishing guide for some local fishing. If you will accept our invitation, we would be most grateful, since we know that your attendance would greatly enhance this very special weekend. We thank you for giving consideration to our invitation. With warmest regards, the Conway Board of Selectmen, and we signed a letter.
That's great.
And I know in this letter they talked about, I understand from the 250th committee, the gentleman loves the fly fish.
That's why that was
put in there.
And who's the guide going to be?
I can't think of his name. Lives on the Bible Spray Road.
That's great.
Just decided Bobby Howell's place. I can't think of his name. Gentleman's name. He does that quite often. I'd like to make a motion to the Board of Selectmen sign this letter.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And I'll take it that I can ask John to come in.
Yes, by all means.
And also put his name on that. Thank you.
That's really nice. Okay, that's very nice. Yeah. Next thing on the agenda is a report on the signage of town property. We asked Tom to look into that, last week, was it? 2 weeks ago?
Yeah, and there are pretty much three different kinds of signs. The immediate concern was for political signage.
Yes, it was. Yeah.
And so I got the rules on that and have the reference there. It's General Laws, Chapter 54, Section 65. So there's a little bit of interpretation, because with early voting, of course, the town office here was also a polling place. Mm-hmm. And at an election, I think she was considering the times that it was open. But, you know, if it could also be during the whole period. So that's something that we still have to flesh out, because the law as written doesn't really reflect the new early voting procedures. So this is the law as it applies to that. And what they have said is that the triangle in front of the library is within 150 feet.
Right.
So they don't want anything within that. And we have a map that shows exactly where it is.
Two houses down the line, I think.
Yeah, and of course we don't want people in the street either.
That's something to think about in the future with early polling, if it's a different location.
Yes, yes indeed. Yeah. Different location, different times. So that's, then outside of the prohibitions in the law, though, there are no provisions about political signage. This means that at times when there are no elections taking place, without a policy that the board would set, political signs are not illegal within 150 feet of a polling place. Now, again, this was spurred by a concern about signs on town property.
Right.
This doesn't have to do with, of course, people's private property, though the private property is also affected by the 150-foot rule.
I think somebody asked about the triangle at the other end of the town.
So there are, so there's still a policy to be decided on that. Mm-hmm. So for business signage, I just copied what's in the town bylaws there, which is pretty clear, but also very limited. It only has to do with business signs.
Well,
and
one question I would have with the business signs also is realtor signs. They love to stick them things up everywhere and then don't take them down.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, they're going right on the common right over here right now, on the Memorial Common, facing up Academy Hill Road.
Oh, okay. So that's a commercial sign, again, on town property, which would need a policy.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's something you think you could.
There's nothing in the bylaw about that. Right. This sort of assumes that the signs are on the business's property itself. Right. So
our biggest concern is the signs that are on the town property.
Right. And then there's just community signage, sort of public invitations to public events, that sort of thing. And it's my understanding the town has traditionally allowed community groups, both formal and informal, to use town property, especially the library triangle, to advertise events that are open to the public.
So that would be like saying baseball Saturday.
Yeah. I think the festival sometimes puts a sign up there, as well as, you know, on the 16.
Upper triangle, we have the church sign. It's been there for 150 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that there's a business on the Whaley Road that puts a sign up the day she's open, but she takes it down that evening.
Right, that's
just
true.
Just a temporary, quick little sign. So it's not something that's there all the time.
But those would be on-premise signs.
Right.
So that one would be.
On town property signs.
Well, but hers is on town property? The one on Whaley Road?
Yes, it is.
Uh-huh.
It's on that common.
Oh, it's on the common. I see, yeah.
So commercial signs on town property are something that needs a policy as well. And while there may be desirable limits on the size and type of such signage, you know, no flashing neon lights, mm-hmm. perhaps, I see no reason why community events open to the public should not be allowed to be advertised.
Right.
That's
right.
Fine. I don't see anything anywhere that says anything about that. Clearly, signage can be a useful way to disseminate information to the public. Business signs are regulated, and therefore the province of the planning board. Now, that's business signs on premises.
On their own premises, right.
So I'll...
Up here it says off-premise signs are allowed, but they only can, like, give directions. So, like, a realtor sign, they have an arrow saying, you know, open house.
Right.
With an arrow
point. Right. And that's not an on sanju. That's not what is addressed in our current protective bylaws. So that, and again, on town property, that calls for a select board policy.
Right.
So political signage, the general laws are specific only to times at which elections are being held, mm-hmm. and restrict signage only within 150 feet of the polling place. So that says nothing about public property either. So my recommendations are to prohibit political signs on all town property. That is would be both simple and fair. It would avoid any bias or possible vandalism for which the town might then be held responsible. Right. The argument against that is that it prevents the expression of local sentiments. But again, I still recommend that. And what I say is, you know, it could start as a policy and you can see how that works out. But eventually, I think it might be something the town meeting should act on, just so that it is an act of the town and a bylaw and not just a policy of the select board. That way you'll have a chance to gauge the sentiment of the town. And if their sentiment is to change the policy, then you can reconsider that.
Right. Probably not a bad idea.
And business signs, again, on premises are covered. And I don't have a recommendation for business signs on town property, so I will give some more thought to that.
Might be interesting to see if you could somehow ask a few of your surrounding towns what they're, if they have any policies and stuff like this on town property. See what they do with it, too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I will. So then finally, for community groups, I don't think there have been any problems, but if there were a number of groups, I say, that come to have more or less regular events, a single posting facility could be constructed to give each group one or two lines of space within a stylistically coherent framework so that it looks a little bit organized. And that's why I attached
the
photograph, is that...
Well, we tried to figure that a group of town tried to do a public bulletin board a few years ago, uh-huh. 3 or 4 years ago, but they had a $10,000 article and it got shot down on the town meeting floor. Which could be a lighted bulletin board.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. But
that created a lot of stir.
That's down. Right. Nobody liked that even. Yeah. You know,
no.
This is very different. Yeah, yes, I remember that.
Just to describe this, it's two posts and a board on top says community events, mm-hmm. and then there are various boards hung from that people have. Some of them are hand done. Some of them are. They look like they sort of were printed somehow. And I did get the specifications for how. How that is done within that town.
Yeah.
So it's just something to consider if it looks as though there are multiple events, especially.
I thought something like that, this sign here, would actually look pretty decent. Not right here in the center of town, right where anybody's homes by off, right? But like down there, maybe in front of the grammar school.
Mm-hmm.
Just away from the driveway so it doesn't block the view coming out of the highway. Because the town owns it up to the state road there. And you could put that on there for community events and stuff. It wouldn't be a bad idea. I mean, Bruce props one up on that A-frame every once in a while there.
Right.
So people can see it come by because it gets a lot of traffic exposure.
The PTO yep. breakfasts and right. things yep. always post there.
Yep.
Well,
that's something to think about, you know?
Yeah. So I did that I had seen that, so I thought.
That's a good idea.
And you can see how they've made it bigger by extending an arm off one side.
So,
okay.
It's like they got something on the ground, too.
I think they may have been working on it at the time there.
Yeah.
So that is what I came up with. And of course, I'm continuing to look into things. And
great.
And I will continue especially to look for business signs on town property as well, which, well, you know, it's fine unless maybe you get competitors who are, you know, having some kind of a sign competition going on. So that's all, that
so
is
this,
what I have
with,
for that.
This policy of signs on town property involve a motion we'd have to make and vote on? Or a warrant article.
And I think maybe I can add some thoughts and what other towns are doing, and maybe we can talk about
great.
It again
hash it out
with
one more
John
time.
Here.
Great. Sure.
Okay.
Sure.
Yeah.
We'll pull forward. Come up some sensible. Kenny, the police chief would be more than happy to have us had something set in writing, so he can
right
he can enforce it.
So. Yeah.
Very good. Next item on the agenda is budget discussions targeted for fiscal year 18.
Well, I put together some numbers. And there's some good news. We are not as tight up against the wall as I feared we might be. Some of that's because we have more free cash than
we thought.
Than I expected us to have.
So has that been certified, or is that?
Yes.
Oh, great.
Yes. And also, we had some new growth that was a one-time deal, an upgrade of utility infrastructure.
Yeah.
So that helps our levy limit as well as the free cash. So we have some money now. Last year's free cash was $165,000. This year's is about $204,000. Now, relatively speaking, the year before that was something like $360,000.
Yeah.
And that is it's hard to say an average for the town because it's jumped up and down so much.
Yes, yes.
But the average was somewhere around $350,000 to $400,000. So it's a little bit less than the typical amount we've been used to, but it's much less tight than it was last year.
Okay.
Last year's levy limit, the current levy limit is up $255,000. So together, there's a maximum of $460,000 that could be spent.
But if we spent that whole,
well, yeah, and
our taxes would go up.
I do get into that. So last year's spending on schools was up close to $200,000 from the previous year, and I have a spreadsheet that shows from fiscal year 13 through 17. What the spending on all the school lines was and the percent increases. And that's going to come in handy later when I do, I'm not quite ready yet for a long-term projection for finances, but I'm almost ready with that. So our four-year average...
So it says last year the budget went up 6%?
6.22% for schools. And its four-year average was 4.43%. So that's one of the things that people are feeling in their pocketbooks this year. So it's... And, you know, what I should say...
So you estimate they're probably going to be asking about $140,000 more overall in somewhere in that vicinity? Well, we're not sure about that yet. But.
It's actually this year's spending on schools was up from the previous year. So it's this year's it's this year's taxes that are being affected by that 6.22%. So the average it goes up is almost 4.5%. So for budgeting purposes, it's nice to add a contingency of 10%. So that would make the average rise 4.87%, or just putting it up to 5% is even safer.
Was there a one-time reason for going up 6.25%?
A lot of that was due to the technical school rise.
There wasn't insurance increases too, or something.
Like the health insurance was
crazy. I think
both for the town and the school, it went up a lot more than it we were used to, because it had been zero for many years, and then there was a relatively large jump. Again, averaged out, it wasn't so much, but it hit all at once, so everybody noticed it. So if we count 5% very conservatively as a rise in school spending, though not as much as it went up this year, so 5% may sound conservative, but it's actually not as much as it went up this year, that would require an additional $203,000, which is almost exactly what our free cash is. So all of a sudden, all of this extra money seems to, you know, not be just floating out there. So that leaves just $256,000 to cover all capital items, mm-hmm. any special warrant articles, and any pay raise. So now it begins to seem just a little bit tighter.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
For the town budget, if we spent the total, it would be almost an 8% increase, which translates into a 6.6% rise in taxes. Again, that's a very hefty tax rise.
Yeah,
For the minimal amount, if just the schools were funded, if you didn't spend any extra money on capital items, or any special warrant articles, or any pay raises, that would mean a 3.04% rise in taxes. So, assuming full funding of the schools, the target, which you can set as a policy, and then I try to meet that, a target for a tax rise in fiscal year 18 will therefore have to be between about 3.04%, depending on the final numbers for the school, and the maximum allowed, which is 6.6%. Again, for comparison, last year's levy went up about 6%. So something we can probably do a bit better than we did for this year, mm-hmm. so the rise would not be quite so much. So the average, you know, between those two, if you split the difference, it's about 4.5% rise. That would be additional spending of about $200,000. And so that would be what's left for any capital items, any special warrant articles, and any pay raise. So that is, these are my, and of course, the school spending is completely an estimate, but all the other numbers are good. So that's just to give you an idea of, well, right. If taxes were going to go up 4.5%, between 3 and 6.5, roughly, that would be, we'd have $200,000 to allocate to capital, special warrant articles, and any pay raise. And that's really all I have to say now.
I'd like to
you'll
see
have to have a discussion
what's really
going to
happen at school, because I understand they're... Mm-hmm. I believe I heard somebody say that their student population is down quite a bit this year.
I don't know, really.
So, if their school population continues to go down, I can't see how they can continue asking for a 5 or 6% increase every year.
Well, and here's one of the difficulties. The school budgets are the last budgets we
right.
get.
Right.
And they come in very late. So all of my budgeting is going to have to be done well before we have any hard numbers for the school. Again, mm-hmm. I've tried to suggest that a 5% rise in the school budget would be a conservative way to think about it. Mm-hmm. And we can certainly let the school know that we're, you know, that we have limits, and our budget assumptions are based on they're not going up too much.
So in the past, when the school population went down, they admitted students for school choice. I don't know whether...
I don't know what
and that...
Well...
that brings in basically school income.
And you can also see that the Conway Grammar School is, you know, it's the thing we spend most money on. But if you add up Frontier and the technical schools, it's not that far away from.
Yeah.
It's about 40% to 60% of the school spending.
I thought that the grammar school was fairly full, but it's at the high school. The population is down.
So
I shouldn't say this, but I thought I heard somebody say that the student population at a grammar school was down about 45 students this year. I could be wrong with that. Yeah. I don't know. I have not seen the exact figure, so I don't know.
That would be a lot.
Yeah.
That would be.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, that's just
three classrooms.
Right,
so. And, you know, the problem there is that if it's spread over the whole school, mm-hmm. then you have to think about, you know, if it were just the whole fifth grade or something, you could say, oh, well, obviously we're not going to need a fifth grade teacher mm-hmm. this year or something. But
we need a fifth grade teacher.
It's usually spread,
yeah.
you know, across the whole population, and then the principal has to think about combining.
Well, the principal looks at
classes,
what's coming up in the future, too.
First and second, third and fourth, that sort of thing. So, yeah, it's very difficult to plan. Usually things, that would be a whole lot to change in 1 year. But we shall see. Anyway, these are good school numbers.
Mm-hmm.
They're good numbers for the budget discussion, except we have to make some assumptions about the school.
Yep.
So what I would say is, you know, think about, you know, your target for how much you want taxes to go up, and of course that'll be a little bit dependent on the requests that are made.
Right.
But
so basically, if we didn't want the taxes to go up at all, you'd have to pretty much offset all that free cash into the increase in schools. If you want to try to keep your tax rate the same this next year.
Well, the tax rate could be the same. That, of course, that depends on the valuation
right,
of the
right.
of the property. But for total taxes,
mm-hmm.
But there are always a lot of things that we spend free cash on in town meeting. Not the schools. I mean, a police car or.
Mm-hmm.
Well, and that's, you know, there's the capital items like that. There are special articles.
Yeah.
And then there's, you know, any pay, any salary differential.
Yeah. All righty. Have you got any more on that, Tom? Are you pretty all set?
No, that's it.
Okay. Hey, Bob, you have something?
Sure. You know, I don't think we can hope to have the taxes stay the same.
Right. Next item is our long-term financial planning and draft policies.
So this is continuing the community compact discussion on long-term financial planning.
Mm-hmm.
We've gotten a newer draft of policies from Joe Markarian.
This is the whole package here, not pretty much.
This is what we have for now. It's not going to be the entire document. It's just the well, you can let's see. Yeah, and the page numbers in the table of contents right now do not match. They go up through we go up through the accountant here for employee guidelines, and I think what he's done is he's taken some of these employee guidelines and he's put them under financial policies
mm-hmm.
Because we do have a number of internal controls that have already been approved by the select board, mm-hmm. and we did send those into him. So he's looking at more of the things that we don't have yet. Mm-hmm. And you can see that he has included in his, in the cover sheet there, mm-hmm. He has some what he's considering minor word changes.
And to hear the page numbers look like they're probably correct.
On the top. Yeah, and then he lists six decisions for the select board and the finance committee to consider and agree on as well. And I would like to have some of that discussion happen while we meet with the finance committee on budgetary items as well. As long as we're meeting with them, we can also suggest that we cover some of these policy matters as well. So really all I have to say is, but you know, if we can all familiarize ourselves with the decision points that Joe has identified and try to get some initial thoughts about that, you know, if there's anything for Conway that has a special case or something like that, he's looked at many, many towns.
So this is basically the document that he gave us to start with,
yes.
Customized for Conway.
Yeah. Yes, and he has, he's fixed it up a little bit, polished it a little bit, and most importantly, identified the questions that we need to answer before he can go forward and finalize the
And those are these decisions the on the front page?
Yes, yes.
Great.
Mm-hmm. So I guess all I would say for now is take a look at them, yeah. Think about them. The numbers that he's using are typical numbers, but they're not necessarily the best numbers for Conway. So this is where we get we can tweak it a little bit if we want. For instance, the free cash policy, I think our free cash has tended to be higher than 5%. And that's partly because we haven't wanted to borrow. So we've funded a lot of our stabilization funds and our capital expenses through free cash rather than borrowing. So that's the kind of thinking that that we're going to have to engage in as we go forward. And that's all I have for that.
Great.
Great.
Any questions for you, Bob?
Good reading here.
Any questions, Tom?
No. Okay.
All righty, let's see here. Next item is any new business?
No new business.
Okay, we'll cross that off. Items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of this meeting.
I don't have anything.
Okay, we'll pass over that. Do you have an administrator update, Tom?
Oh, I do. For committees and boards, the planning board notes that an application for a special permit has been filed for an in-law apartment at 223 Sheldon Falls Road. The plans are on top of the file cabinet near the water cooler in this office. If the select board has any comments, questions, or objections to the issuance of such a special permit, please notify the Conway Planning Board prior to December 1st, 2016. So if you want to look at them, I can put it
I've
on the...
I've always gone out to them. I had to go up to the resident being
oh,
fire
right,
chief
right.
and
yeah.
go with them and stuff in there.
So yeah. if anyone has any opinions about it, we should put it on the agenda. Let me know. The co-chair of the planning board, Joe Strugowski, along with the building inspector and I, visited a site which had been the subject of a noise complaint, and there was a question of sand and gravel being removed.
And we talked about this a couple weeks ago.
Yes, and since then we've made the site visit. While some sand and gravel has clearly been removed, it is impossible to determine how much or whether the landscape has been changed enough to have violated Conway's protective bylaws. We obtained a verbal agreement with the owners that they would get a special permit before removing any more material. And I've spoken to the complainants about that, and they are watching.
You'll be the first to know. In other words, right?
Yeah.
One log goes out, telephone starts ringing.
And the Open Space Committee is planning a joint meeting with the Planning Board on the future of the Rose property. There's a bit of mail about that you can read if you want. On Thursday, November 17th at 7 p.m. And of course, that is open and the public is welcome to attend. The assessors are having to move to a new platform for their state work and are considering the vendor of choice of the state. So the state has gone out to all the computer people and said, who can do this for us? They've picked somebody. They're not making the towns go with that vendor, but there are advantages that the state has identified. And so far, our assessors like what they have seen. They do have some questions. They're getting them answered. But so it will mean some adjustment in the short term, but could save, should save money over the long term. So for departmental news, it came up last time. I am pleased to report that special town meetings only cost the copying and postage required to send the warrants to all households. Registrars are paid $100 stipends for the year, regardless of how many registration days there are. So there are no hourly fees attached to that. Same with election workers. Officer Williams is considering, Police Officer Williams, is considering pursuing a grant for one or more pedestrian signs for downtown that could light up when a button is pushed. He feels this would be especially important for times when there are a number of people downtown. Maybe you've seen some of these in Amherst, near Amherst College. There, if a pedestrian, it's like a walk button for a crosswalk. So it lights up if anybody wants it to. That was a concern that arose out of the most recent Festival of the Hills. Unfortunately, our tree warden has decided to resign in the face of long work hours and family obligations. If anyone who hears this is interested in becoming a tree warden or knows of anyone who might be interested, please let me know as soon as possible. Oddly enough, we actually make a good deal of use of our tree warden because many residents have questions about trees that are on their land, which may or may not be potential hazards for town roads.
So what do we do about this work when someone tries to get help? Can we contract that out to another tree warden?
I am in discussions with our highway superintendent about, because we do contract out for a lot of tree
work. Yeah, yeah.
However, we really do want somebody who's our town tree warden.
Does it have to be a resident of town?
I suppose it doesn't. But it shouldn't be somebody who's too far away.
Yeah, because I found it a lot easier when I was dealing with the town public, when I was highway superintendent, to have a separate tree warden rather than have the same person covering both.
Right.
It just makes the highway superintendent's job easier. Because
it's a second opinion.
And it's a second opinion, and then they're not... Because some people, you know, when they got this specific thing stuck in their head, they're only looking for one answer, yes, go ahead. And then you got two people looking at it, you come up with different ideas. And it kind of lets the highway superintendent off the hook a lot of times, which I think is a good thing.
Yes. Thank you for that observation. I hadn't considered that as another major reason that we need a tree warden.
Yeah.
So, kick that around, and that's all I've got for that.
Okay. Alrighty, next item on the agenda is concerns of the selectmen. Do you have any, Bob?
Nope.
I guess my only, it's not really a concern, I'm just wondering is how are we managing? I see a couple weeks ago we had ads for a new hiring employee. How are we coming on that, Tom?
Yes. Well, we didn't get anyone apply who was obviously, this is exactly the kind of person we want in our highway department. So we're still considering the options and whether or not to go out for another ad or just use contract plow people for the winter. It's a question now. Now it's more of a question of an extra person to plow during the winter than it would be if we were hiring in the spring or the summer. So
the applicants didn't have CDLs, and there was or
they all had different
variations.
They were widely different, and none who really stood out as.
How many did you have applying?
I think there were three. There may have been four, but I think there were just three. Mm-hmm. And it's not as though the people couldn't necessarily be trained to do the job. We were hoping for somebody who had plow experience, because it makes a difference.
Yeah, it does.
Or experience in using power tools and things, mm-hmm. which was actually in the ad. So some people have a little bit of one but not another, and it might be best at this point to go with contractors for plowing, and then re-advertise for the laborer in the spring. I don't think we've finalized, you know, a decision on that, but that's I think where it's going to go.
I would think you would maybe put something in the visitor and then suggest maybe that you should just leave that open, that position open, till it's filled.
Well, that's essentially what it is.
Mm-hmm. Christina, somebody might come along, somebody read the newspaper in town, something, may have a family relative that moves in or something. You never know what possibilities would be, but.
Right. Well, I think if we do contract with somebody, they'll have a specific route, and that'll at least be their work through the winter. And
well, I wish them well at finding part-time help in the winter months, because I know when I was superintendent of 20 years, it was really, really hard to find somebody to want to plow snow part-time. Because most everybody at that point had held on full-time jobs of their own, you know.
And we have no idea how much snow we're going to get.
Yeah, we have no idea, right? Exactly right.
Yeah.
All right, that was the only concern I had, I guess. We're still working on the
mail, yeah, there's that.
Are we still working on those overhead doors for the highway facility?
Yeah, as far as I know, I haven't heard an update. I'll try to get an update on that.
Okay. And is that something was going to be tried to be done this fall, or was
there no something time that was supposed to be done the last fiscal year? Yeah. So, yes. It would be very good to get that done before the really cold weather settles in.
All righty, next agenda is mail. We have this one letter that says to the Conway Open Space Committee has developed primary plans for open space uses for the town field on the Shelton Falls Road, formerly Rose property. This vision will be presented Thursday, November 17th, 7 p.m. at the Town Hall during a combined public information session and a joint meeting of the Planning Board and Open Space Committee. Datress Lloyd Sanders will be present and recommendation resulting from her assessment of biological inventories and potential uses for the property, tentatively named River Bend Meadow. Must be they want to change the name to River Bend Meadow. Proposals by section of the 11-acre field will be portrayed with visuals. Many uses suggested by townspeople are incorporated, including walking trails, Salt River viewing station, in a picnic area. Citizens are encouraged to attend and participate in the discussion. That's Thursday, November 17th, at 7 p.m.
So that's the second time we've talked about that meeting.
Yep.
Yeah.
If anybody's got any visions of what they might want to see down there, it's probably a good meeting to go to. So.
And everyone there is aware that we do have a 3-year agreement with Mr. Topp.
Mr. Topp. Yeah. And that looks excellent down there, by the way. Everything came in really good, didn't it?
Yeah.
The river project is greened up. His field is greened up. It's nice. Really nice.
Getting rain worked.
Okay, next on the agenda item is announcements. Do we have any announcements for anybody that needs to make?
I don't know of anything. I'm going to be at a Mass Managers Conference this Thursday and Friday. That's all.
That's MMA?
Say. Yeah.
It's Friday?
Yeah. Down at UMass, actually.
So oh, it is?
Very handy.
Is that an all-day adventure? What is it, Tom?
Yes. Yeah, okay. It's the big fall
conference. So you'll be out of office on Friday?
They have a fall conference. They have a, yeah, Thursday and Friday.
That's
well, because it's sort of half day on Friday anyway, so.
Yeah. Okay. And no word on the secretary when she's coming back, I guess, huh? You said?
No. No, she got hit pretty hard.
Yeah. Alrighty, other than that, so everything for this evening. I guess the next meeting is going to be scheduled for Monday, November 21st at 7 p.m. here in the town office. That's next Monday.
That's a week, yep.
If I hear no further business of the organization, I make a recommendation that we adjourn.
So move.
Second, all those in favor?
Aye.
I think the meeting's closed. Thank you.